great joy for me, and I know it's been great. I really love bringing this music to the audience out here in Suffolk County. This is a rather unusual concept, but it's the title of the series, Baroque Sundays at 3, but we're not going to hear, you're not going to hear any Baroque music today. That's much too late for this crowd. It's all medieval music. It'll be very, very exciting. I'll talk a little bit more about it and about the artist when I come back. There's going to be a short intermission that's not mentioned at the moment, but if you look at your program, after the set that begins with Elas Avril, they're going to take a short break and I'll come out and talk a little bit more. Of the two artists, Krista Patton actually got a DMA here as a historical harp player. That's the one great thing about Stony Brook is that there's a flexibility, even though there's no historical harp teacher, we can still make it work. So I'll talk about that also when I come out. But for the time being, really enjoy. You're going to hear all sorts of instruments that you may never have heard before, and it's going to be a great, we'll have a great time. See you later. Thank you.
Thank you. hear this old dusty music, which we're dusting off for you, especially for you. This is a bagpipe, and it's a Renaissance style bagpipe, but also, you know, they're very old instruments, and we know them as the Highland pipes from Scotland. Scots came over from Scotland to help us fight the revolution, fight the English, and win the revolution. So we claim those as our bagpipes, and in fact, I think we think of them as the bagpipes. But in fact, there are so many different kinds of bagpipes. It's a world instrument. I've seen Persian bagpipes. There's bagpipes from everywhere, and continental Europe has plenty of variety in its bagpipes. To them, the Scottish pipes are sort of exotic, you know. And so these are a conjectural set of 15th or 14th century pipes, two drones, hello, and a chanter. Next we're gonna play, so our program is loosely based on animals, and so our pieces are about different animals, but we're starting off with a plant, Rosabella, one of the most famous pieces of three-part polyphony from the 14th century by Johannes Ciconia, an Italian composer from the late 13th, early 1400s.
And in case you're interested in form, we're going to do a truncated form of A, B, B, A. So if you hear a repetition in the middle, it's the B section is being repeated. And then if you hear a return home, it's the A section. And then you'll know that we're done.
You might want to tell us that when we get there.
Thank you.
It's strung in gut. I'm sure if you've come to the Sundays at Baroque or Baroque Sundays at 3, you'll probably notice that all the instruments are strung in gut. This one has a bird on it, so it's kind of useful in this particular song as a visual guide for all the bird-like sounds. And do you want to talk about the second one?
Or I'll talk about it then, yeah.
Okay. I'm going to stand up.
Okay.
I'm going to stand up. Yes. All right. This is how duos work. We have a lot of compromises. If you need to stand, then we'll stand. If you don't, you don't.
It's a big double reed that I have here, and it's wide, so it gives it sort of a shallow, like, sort of clarinet sound. But it's called the Dusen, and the Dusen means, you know, it's like a, some kind of sweet sounding instrument. Because it's a double reed, and it's sort of constructed like a louder, like the shawm, which is its louder cousin, they... it seems that it's we don't know much about them. The only reason that we know what they are is that they a collection, a consort of them, was found in the hold of a ship that sunk called the Mary Rose, I think it was, off of England during the time of, I think, Henry VIII, maybe Queen Elizabeth I. But so there was a consort of these, and because you play them with reeds, reeds don't really last, you know, they disintegrate over time, and the reed is what is the key to how the instrument works, how it's supposed to sound, how loud it is, how soft it is. So there's been a lot of experiments, reconstructing this instrument, making versions of this instrument, and this one is from Switzerland, and the reed is wide because the builder, and also I, was thinking maybe these are related to a modern instrument that's a traditional oboe from Armenia called the duduk. And the duduk has a wide reed and has a sort of soft, mellow sound like this. So this could be an early version of that. So that's why this instrument sounds like this. Other times people will put just like a small reed on it, and it sounds just kind of like it sounds a little less, I feel, it sounds a little less sexy. If you thought this was sexy, then, then you're thinking along the same lines as me. But if you had heard the other versions of this, it sounds kind of like somebody has like a snotty nose and they're kind of scratching. And this is a maybe a more successful version of this instrument. But we really don't know how it sounded. Next we're going to play another bird song called Parmenfoy. And it's both Orsu and this one have similar texts. And the basic idea is that the nightingale, the beloved nightingale, the subject, the rossignol, the subject of many poems over centuries, and it's certainly associated with love. And the rossignol sings of love in a way that is really nice. This is the author's point of view. Rossignol is allowed to sing of love, but the cuckoo is not, because the cuckoo had a reputation for stealing eggs from nests, and so in the poetry, I think the cuckoo became, the devious other who stole the true love, and so the cuckoo is not allowed to sing of love. Instead, the cuckoo needs to be murdered and slain and killed, and those words are put forth in this through, they've sort of taken the words osi, 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 and tue, osi, osi, we're going to kill you, fideli, you are unfaithful, you rob the loyal, and so the bird sounds are just sort of messed up versions of those words, we're going to kill you, we're going to slay you. So you'll hear me playing them. Those are the bird calls.
Thank you.
Maybe I'll just say a couple words about this instrument. This is a viol. If you think of it anachronistically, it's as if you put a viola and a violin together. So you have high strings and low strings. It's a really useful instrument because you can play drones lower. If you heard sometimes I would accompany Krista with drones. Then you can also play tunes. It's a five-string instrument, and this is in today when people try to think about how these instruments were made or looked like, they usually look at iconography because not many of these survive. So the luthier who made this in Rhode Island in Providence, he looked at a lot of like iconography and discussed stuff with art historians. And it came up with this model, which works really well. And my bow is really basic, right? It's just, it's this shape, and there's horsehair on it. There's nothing exotic about it. It doesn't even, if you want to loosen the strings, you have to take out the frog, which I usually don't because I'm worried that I won't be able to get it back in.
This next piece, Hélas et Rire, is by Matteo da Perugia, who was an Italian composer like Ciconia, but wrote in a very French style. He was in Milan in the late 1300s, early 1400s, and this is a piece that just, it creates this sort of balmy, sort of the steam rising after the winter up from the ground in the springtime. At least that's how I feel about it. It's very atmospheric, and when I studied in Italy, I noticed that when spring does come, which is sort of early in February, March, you have this feeling that where the sun returns and you can't look or do anything that you had planned on. You just have to sort of push back and look out the window and you fall under the spell of the earth and the sun and the life returning in the spring. So this piece, we're going to try to evoke that with our little sticks and horse hair. Yes, we will. I promise we'll do it. ABCA.
Thank you.
manuscript and dated around the 1400s. It's a purely instrumental music, whereas the last piece we played, like many of them, were vocal pieces. And so it has no words, and so it's a very different sounding composition. It actually, there's been discussion amongst the scholars that it has Middle Eastern influences. It has forms that seem like Turkish court music, but really no one's really able to prove that. It might just be purely Italian instrumental music, which is very kind of exotic sounding.
And maybe I'll just say that instrumental music that was written down from before 1400, there's not a lot of it. There may be 40 pieces have survived. Most of the music is improvised, which is why a lot of the music we play, most of the music we play is vocal music. But in this program, we have two instrumental dances that were written down and that have survived.
Thank you.
season. They're quite amazing. I'm fascinated listening to this music as well. How often you get a chance to hear these instruments of great players, it's rare. It's really, the second half of the program will be even more exciting, I think. I talked a little bit before about Krista Patton, who did a DMA here. She was in my studio. I don't teach any of those instruments, but the one thing that's great about Stony Brook is that there's a flexibility to accept people who do almost anything, really. And she was under my supervision. I could coach her in music, also this early, but also Baroque music. And my job was also just to make sure that she was getting instruction from, let's say, harp teachers. And throughout the years, we've had a number of early music majors at Stony Brook. There was a recorder major a number of years ago. There was somebody who had started out in the trombone studio and decided he really wanted to go into sackbut playing. He was able to do a whole recital of sackbut. Greg Ingles, he's now maybe the leading sackbut player in this entire country now. His wife was the same thing. She was a trumpet major, decided what she wanted to do was early, Baroque trumpet, like the second Brandenburg Concerto of Bach. And she's now teaching at the University of Indiana, Baroque trumpet. So we accept those kinds of things. There's a place for everybody, that kind of flexibility. You don't find that in very many places in this country. So that's one of the reasons I've been so happy to teach here all these years. Wanted to just go over a little bit about the rest of the program, the rest of the season. Just before Thanksgiving, a week and a half before, is the Baroque Ensemble concert. It's going to be very exciting. We're going to be doing some of Handel's water music. It's quite a change from this. But there'll be a lot of early Italian music, the vocal and instrumental music, like up through Bach and Handel. There'll be an excerpt from the B minor Mass as well in the box, so please try to come to that. And then next spring we go on, and I'll be playing the Goldberg Variations of Bach. If you're around, please come to that in February. And then we have something that's very exciting that's going to be in March, we hope, of a recently rediscovered opera from Prague in the 17th century that has been unearthed by one of our wonderful musicologists, Eric Honisch, who's in the audience at the moment. These are things you're not going to hear anywhere else but here, really. And we end in April with another Baroque Ensemble concert that's going to be also pretty stellar. You probably saw when you came in that there was a donation box, and I really thank you for all your generosity. If you like what you hear, please, you want to be more generous, or if you missed the box, it'll still be there at the end. Every penny that goes into that box goes into a special early music fund at Stony Brook Foundation, and it's used to help bring people here, and also helps, like I talked about the sackbut player, it helped. I was able to buy mouthpieces when he was here, thanks to that fund. Also to help rehair bows, even to help buy bows and help support early music. So please, if you see it on the way out, we accept money on the way out as well as in. And again, every penny goes to a very good cause of supporting early music here. So enjoy the rest of the concert. They will be here at the end if you want to ask about see their instruments up close. I'm sure they'll be happy to talk to you about all these exotic instruments. So enjoy the rest of the show. Thank you.
Thank you.
the snake makes his appearance in that song in our beasts program. Someone's looking over a pool of water and sees something that he thinks is a snake. I could be wrong about this, but my old Italian is failing me at the moment. And then the snake turns into like this woman who's like, you're a human.
So this next piece is also a song. It's a three-part song that's been intabulated, meaning it's been turned into an instrumental piece. So we didn't have to do it ourselves. Someone did it for us.
In the 1400s.
In the 1400s. Not like last week. And so there, and it's been turned into a two-part piece, which oftentimes people will play on the organ. Since you have two hands, we're doing it this way.
Which is the Sean. this piece, Aquila Altera, has three different texts. It's a three-part piece of poetry, but it's really a lot more along the lines of what we just did with the Faenza credits, which is two. It was unusual because it had two lines of music, but they were written in score with bar lines through the top staff and the bottom staff. And from the 14th century, you don't usually see notation that way, where it's written in score. And so it looks like a piano part, but as Don said, there's lots of conjecture as to how it was played. And they were all in tabulations, like sort of reductions of these larger pieces, these polyphonic pieces, like Elas that we just played, although that one's not in it, but a lot of really well-known or popular pieces at the time wound up sort of reduced into these two lines. And the top line was just very, very ornamented, and so that's the Faenza codex, which is another source of instrumental music from the time. This is a piece that's in three parts, like the usual vocal pieces, but it's very, it actually can be played with only two, and I think the middle part might have been, we've got cousin so-and-so along that's writing a part, so it doesn't really add that much, so we're doing it with just two. And it's about the, but it has three different texts, Aquila Altera, Creatura, and Dio, that are sung simultaneously the same, when the piece is performed in three parts. So it's a cacophony of words and notes. And it's, of course, eagle on high. Told and retold. from a manuscript that it's believed to be a dance, but actually it also reminds me of bits of music that were used to help tell a story. And storytellers in Italy were called cantastori, and they would sing and tell stories, and they might have the help of like a little smidge of a melody here and there to like sing a little bit of the tale and then speak a little bit. And they would often use the harp to propel it forward. They'd use the harp or even a viol to tell the stories and accompany themselves. So, although we don't really know for sure, I conjecture that maybe this piece had something to do with telling of the story of Tristan and Isolde. Is all about the power of the ruling really good and bow and scrape to them, you will have a wonderful existence. And it's probably, it's, you could consider this piece a musical emblem of the rulers of Lucca. And they put forth their panther in the company of Mars, the god of war.
Thank you.
It's a song about a donkey, and it's a song about an exalted donkey. We think that a donkey may have been led into the church in this feast as part of this feast. Some people think it's part of the Feast of Fools. So I'm going to play this song just in its own way, or in my own way. I add in a few donkey brains, so you should listen out for donkey brains. But it's kind of a reverie on this song. I think I play maybe 3 or 4 verses of the song.
Thank you.
script as the orientis that Dong Myung played earlier. And so we thought we would add it. It's full of some of the most wonderful melodies ever. And it's hard not to just roll around in it for a while. We're going to finish up as we started with the bagpipes and the piano. I'm going to do something called Canto lo Gallo, the song of the rooster. And the sentiment is that everybody hears the song of the rooster, which also brings about sweet desire. I'll just leave it at that. And after that, we're going to play a saltarello from that same collection of dances that the Lamento di Tristano was from, and also Bevica, although they're from the same period and they're all Italian medieval dances.